This is Ham Radio Now, as always, the most important amateur radio program on the internet. And this is our generic introduction to one of the 2017 ARL and Tapper Digital Communications Conference talks. The DCC was held in St. Louis in September 2017. Who knows what year it is when you're watching this? Okay, let's roll in the title. And you can see which one of the talks it is right down there in the title. If you're listening to the audio podcast, well, your app already gave you the title. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and I produced and edited the DCC video series and stood there with the camera recording them all. And the only reason to record this introduction at all is to ask you for money. I didn't run a Kickstarter to support producing the DCC videos this year, and with travel, hotels, equipment, editing time, they get kind of expensive to produce. So I'm asking you to make a contribution to Ham Radio Now to pay me for doing them. It's pretty easy. Just go to the website, hamradionow.tv, do the click here to enter thing, and then when you get there, click the pig. That's Arvin, our chief financial officer and our mascot. And you get to our contribution page. And then you got three options. There is the Patreon, which sets up a monthly contribution. That's something that's good if you're generally supporting Ham Radio Now all year long. Maybe not if you want to do the Tapper Conference. If you want to just do a one-time contribution, then it would be this credit card. And you can click on the donate button. Or if you've got a PayPal account, it's also good for a one-time contribution. You can use a credit card in PayPal as well. And finally, the Kickstarters always offered a $150 level contribution, for which you got this little USB drive with all of the programs on it in high-definition video. So, last year was a 64 gigabyte USB 3 USB drive, so it was a pretty good high-quality one. Without the Kickstarter, there's still a way to do that. It's through the PayPal, and you just open that up and go down to this level, the $150 level, and get the DCC USB drive, and I'll see that you've ordered that or made a contribution for it, and when all the programs are done, then you'll get that. Back to the website for a second. Take a look up here at the top. If you want a link to all of the DCC videos going all the way back to 2008, we've got them here on the website. It's right under the episodes menu. Look down here and you'll see Tapper DCC. Let me bring that up to full screen. You see Tapper DCC. And if we switch on that, then there's several links. There's the DCC videos from 2011 to the present. Those are the ones that went straight to YouTube. There are DCC videos from 2008 and 2009, and those are the ones that we did on DVD back in the day when that was the thing. And I didn't do the DCC in 2010, but there are DVDs available, and this link will take you to them, and you can buy them directly from Tapper. So let me take a look at one of the YouTube playlists, and you can see what that looks like. This is just a simple, it was the easiest way for me to put together a list of things from the Tapper conferences. And you'll also notice that there's a few programs that are not necessarily DCC, but that I thought you might be interested in. There's the Tapper Banquets, Tapper Forums from Dayton, and like this program here, Carl Loffer's RTL SDR program. That was something we recorded from Dayton. It wasn't a Tapper talk, but something that I think you guys would be interested in. One last thing. Tapper and I would like these programs to reach every ham who might be interested in them, and that is harder than you might think. There's a lot of media out there, and it is all competing for your attention. So you can help by spreading the word to your friends in real life and in social media like Facebook and Twitter. In real life, you know, maybe mention them at a radio club meeting or on a net, or put a notice in your club newsletter. Just you get the word out as best you can. That would be a really, really helpful thing for you to do for us. And the best place to point people is to the hamradionow.tv website, or more specifically, to hamradionow.tv slash TAPR-DCC. And that'll get people there. All right, let's go to St. Louis and whichever Tapper talk this is.
Okay, Steve, you ready?
Yeah.
Okay, so now like to introduce a talk. I should say it's also a paper that's published in the proceedings, submitted by Wally Ritchie, WU1Y. And Wally was planning to be here, and he lives in Orlando, and he's wrestling with this big woman named Irma. So he said he regretted that he couldn't be coming here, but he did tap on to Steve Conklin here, AI4QR, to be able to present his paper here at the DCC. The title is Ground-Based DVB-S2 Repeater for Geosynchronous Satellite.
Thank you. I have talked to Wally since Irma came through. He's fine. His house is fine. He just wanted to stay behind and make sure everything was stable and cleaned up and the power's back on and all that. Wally and I are both members of the Phase 4 ground team. Phase 4 is an AMSAT project that has multiple teams. The flight side team is kind of ITAR, U.S. citizen only stuff because we're flying on a U.S. Air Force vehicle. The ground team and the ground station is totally open source, worldwide. People contribute from all over, and you would be welcome to contribute as well. The paper goes into a lot of detail about the actual repeater. This is going to be a kind of higher level overview of the project and how the repeater fits into that. The AMSAT has this phase designation for different types of satellites. Phase 4 is geosynchronous satellites. Phase 4A is currently in the fast pipe to go up. It's rideshare on top of the ESHALE 2 satellite that's being launched out of a group in Qatar. It's scheduled to launch next year. Phase 4B is a rideshare on the Air Force Wide Field of View, and we might make it in 2019. It's kind of as launches are, it's a flexible sliding window that we're trying to hit. Phase 5 is lunar orbit and beyond. There is a CubeSat challenge right now to decide which team might launch on that. And the things that are in common between these are kind of the nickel and dime type 2.5 and 5 gigahertz uplink and 10 gigahertz downlink. And that's why these are bundled together software-wise. Phase 4A is this, it's an amateur satellite project being run out of Qatar Satellite Company's vehicle. It's going to cover Europe, Middle East, and that part of, there's a map coming up, a little bit of Brazil. It's a 2.4 gigahertz uplink, 10 gigahertz downlink. It's linear, it's all linear, where Phase 4B is going to be all digital. And they are two linear traditional bent pipe transponders that work much like ground-based repeaters. There's a narrow channel one that's 8 megahertz wide, and then there's a wide band one that's 8 megahertz, and then a narrow band 250 kilohertz for traditional signals. But the 8 megahertz channel gives us tremendous possibilities to experiment with wide bandwidth signals and modes and all sorts of things that we can play with. This is the SHAL-2 team. This is the coverage area. It's centered over Africa. And the frequency plan, again, shows the wideband uplink and downlink and the narrowband uplink and downlink. Phase 4B is a ride on the Air Force's Wide Field of View geosynchronous satellite. They've given us a place to put our radios, a place to put the antenna, a power budget, and a thermal budget. And it's a free ride on the platform, which is tremendous because it's going to be the first amateur SDR in space. We're going to have a programmable software-defined radio up there that we're free to do with what we want. The partners in that are AMSAT, Millennial Space Systems, Virginia Tech, Many of you know Bob McGweir and his team, and students up at Virginia Tech are doing a lot of the research and mock-ups of the flight side hardware. Rincon Research is providing the SDR that's going on the satellite. ARRL and FEMA are involved because there's a goal for the ground station team to have a man-portable or person-portable ground station for under $1,000 that'll do voice and data over the satellite, and you could drop that into any disaster zone and have digital communications. It's digital only, but we'll be able to put codecs on top of that and do anything we want. The orbit of Phase 4B, currently the projected footprint is from the western part of Africa over to mid-Pacific, so it covers North America. Here's a picture of the something to do with the wide field of view satellite. Some of these are AMSAT, or most of these are AMSAT people, and several of them are Tapper people as well. Phase 4B is 5 and dime. It's 5 gigahertz up and 10 gigahertz down. It's all software-defined radio, all digital. There's a repeater on orbit, which means that we can decode and demodulate the data streams and do error correction and establish links with both separately with the uplink station and the downlink station, and it'll be full duplex. So we've got, in bad error conditions, we're able to actually define on the fly the codecs that are used. We're using the DVB standard, which allows different modulation and encodings to be used on the fly. So we can dynamically change those according to the conditions that the ground stations are encountering. These are in geosynchronous orbit, not geostationary. The difference is that geostationary is a special case of geosynchronous that happens to be inclined over the equator. For geosynchronous satellites, they move around in the sky every day in a figure eight, depending on their orbital inclination. So there will be a little bit of a need to point the antenna, and antenna pointing is going to have to be built into the ground station design. We're certainly uncertain on the launch date, and we're scheduled for 2019 right now. The downlink from Phase 4B will be on 10 gigahertz. It's a single downlink with a maximum efficiency power amplifier. We get a really good data rate using the DVB S2 modulation. We're able to encapsulate multiple virtual channels of downlink data into one encapsulated data stream in that modulation. So all the stations synchronize to the downlink, and they decode all the streams that they want off of that stream. And then up at the satellite, the decision is made about how to partition the different uplinks into downlink channels. So there's some link establishment protocols and assignment work that'll need to be done. I don't know much about this project, so I'm going to skip this slide. The uplink on Phase 4 is 5 gigahertz. It's a lower bandwidth, which makes the station cheaper and easier to build. And it's modest power requirement because it's not really high bandwidth and we're not having to transmit as much data. So we will have individual uplinks on different frequencies, and then those will be aggregated into the DVBS data encapsulation for a single downlink. And stations will decode whichever channel of the downlink they're assigned to. Now, back to Phase 4A. Phase 4A, remember, is a bent pipe sort of transponder where there's no smarts on the satellite, and basically the signal is coming back down, and there will ultimately be multiples of this satellite in orbit. The advantage of a having a ground station, the thing that the paper is written about, which goes into much more detail about link budgets and noise analysis, it's well worth reading. It's difficult and expensive to build a wide channel transmitter for the communications. So you can build a cheap narrow band transmitter or a cheap wide band receiver, but it's more difficult to build a wide bandwidth transmitter that can get to the satellite. So the concept is that you can build a ground station repeater that has that ability, has the power and the ability, and the two ground stations on the outside corners of the slide here only have to receive broadband and transmit narrowband in order to have a link through the repeater to two sites that can't see each other and can't communicate with each other. And this is one of the experimental things that the Phase 4A satellite will allow us to just do experimentation with and use these digital modes and see how well they're going to work. So it's the same sort of thing as Phase 4B, where the ground station transmits on a single narrow link, receives on a single wide link, but the repeater is doing the heavy lifting. DVB-S2 was the standard of choice for this because it's open, it's free, it's widely used. DVB-S2 is the new standard, and there's a generic stream encapsulation standard used for the downlink data, which means we can put arbitrary data inside instead of just putting it. It's designed for more than just video data. There's another standard. This is not covered in the paper, but there's a standard called DVB-T, which is terrestrial, and it's different because terrestrial is different. There's multipath, and there are other considerations that you don't have on a satellite link, which is very clean. The ultimate goal of the ground station project is to support both protocols and to support a ground station that's also internet gateway capable. So if you want to set up mountaintop links or links across cities and plug them into the internet and have satellite stations that also do terrestrial relay, all of that is possible. One of the things that Phase 4 Ground has already driven forward in the amateur radio art is that there are a number already of commercially available DVB decoders that are in ASICs and chips. They don't all support GSE and things like that flawlessly, but there's been great movement forward on DVB encoders and decoders for GNU radio blocks and in software. And a lot of the bugs, some of those existed, some of them didn't. There were bugs in the implementation and various things that were inefficient that had to be tuned up. And there's been a lot of work happening on the Phase 4 Ground project that's driven those projects forward. And it's been really, really cool to see that. A lot of that work's being done with software-defined radios, Blade RF and the Hack RF and the Edis research radios to establish ground links emulating and simulating the satellite links. So one of the interesting things about DVB-S2, it's continuous transmission of frames, and the modcod modulation encoding can actually change with each frame, and the receiver on the fly will deal with that. So if you know the other side of the link has a certain signal path and a certain amount of energy available on the link, you can adjust your coding for that link. And it has very powerful FEC. They have a weird phrase for it in video. It's called, I don't know, it's called essentially flawless or effectively flawless or essentially error-free. It's like a marketing term, but it does turn out to be a very, very low error rate. So in the case of the Phase 4A project, and what this paper is about is the building a repeater. You only need to receive in one location. And the transmitter is just a simple digital channel. It's not a DVB-S2 transmission stream. You can encode digital voice over the data stream, and you obviously, we heard some talks yesterday, we have a choice now of a number of different codecs and bit rates depending on the voice quality that we want. And so this just naturally allows a channel to pile those different codecs on top of that digital data stream. And the expensive equipment, which is the wideband transmitter, is only required at the central repeater location. And since it's on the bent pipe, it'll also coexist with analog mode. So you could also have a setup conversation over the bent pipe while you're setting up the digital modes. So for experimentation, it's going to be very handy. All the details are in the paper, and there are a lot of. It's a great paper. I didn't write it, I can say that I really enjoyed reading it in advance of the conference. Future geosynchronous satellites will have the onboard regenerative repeaters, and that's essentially what phase four is going to be. The ground repeater software is going to be really a useful experimentation platform, and I'm expecting that we'll learn a lot about it that applies to the on-satellite repeater. And with multiple on-orbit satellites, we could provide really, really wide coverage, if not global coverage. And both of these projects, I can't say I know for sure about SHAL, but the Air Force project, I believe, is a prototype for something that could be deployed multiple places. And it would be really amazing if they would continue to give birth to amateur projects on those. And if we could set up a network of geosynchronous satellites, it would be a leap forward for amateur radio. The Phase 4 ground team is totally open. You can find us on the internet. We have a Slack group where people hang out, and you can introduce yourself and start to figure out what's going on the project. There is except when during conference season and DEF CON and Burning Man and other things that keep Michelle Thompson busy, she does a weekly report that's very informative that covers the things that have happened during the week. All the code for the DVB stuff is in the Git repository. Excuse me. There are pieces that we've worked on in the bigger sense of the project, such as a QSO reporting application that'll be a little bit like not logbook of the world, but some of the online log programs actually show you visualizations of your contacts that you've connected with over time. So we have a shell project up for that. And there are a lot of things that are happening with satellite and terrestrial microwave development. There are members of the team that are working on 3D printed horns and dishes for microwave, and there's a design for a feed horn that will allow 5 gigahertz up and 10 gigahertz down on the same dish and reduce the crosstalk to a suitable amount that the harmonic of the uplink doesn't completely destroy your downlink. The ASCENT team is the flight team that's only open to U.S. citizens, but you can apply through the AMSAT site if you'd like to take part in that. And here are the links for more information. This is the source code repository, and I think the README in that will tell you how to find the Slack group. If not, Google will. So that didn't take me very long to go through all that, but I will take questions and answer the ones that I know. Wally's the expert on all this. Go, yeah, sure. Oh, and while I have the mic, when Ward was talking about communities and growing communities and intersecting communities, there's this great thing that happens at Dayton where AMSAT and Tapper take turns hosting a banquet. And there's always a presenter at the banquet, but it's a really great opportunity to get together with a whole bunch of people who talk about interesting things. And if you enjoy this conference, you'll enjoy that banquet a lot too.
Okay, I've got a question about the FEMA connection.
Yeah.
And I don't know if I understand all I know about this, but what I think I understand is that the amateurs basically get in on this deal because FEMA will be able to use it. Is that correct? And how does that happen? Is it, is there something that happens that amateurs are shut off and FEMA can use it during a disaster?
But that's, or is a good, it play question, nice? And I actually know the answer to that.
Okay.
There will be access control to the satellite. First of all, it's a good idea because it can be easily, a denial of service attack could remove the service to everybody that's using the satellite. The details are not finalized, but the current working design is that you will have to be authenticated to access the satellite at all. You'll have to be authenticated as having a license. Now, there's discussion about whether we're going to use whether we're going to use Logbook of the World or other similar mechanisms for doing that. Beyond that, there will be the ability to reserve channels for emergency communication. So there might be 100 channels available on the satellite. 10% of those may be able to be turned off for only access by emergency responders. There's been discussions with commercial vendors after the MSET Phase 4 ground team comes up with a reference design for the ground platform. It's been really interesting. There's this convergence, you know, FPGAs and software-defined radios and all this stuff, just even over the past 2 years has continued to shrink and get cheaper while we're working on this. And a year ago, it was really unclear whether you could build a ground station for $1,000 that could do this. And now it looks totally possible in just a year's time. So there will be a reference design done by the ground team, and then there may be a commercial producer that might take that and commoditize that. And FEMA has expressed an interest, and they haven't committed, but they said they're very interested in purchasing a block of commercial radios that are compatible with this. And it could be, I imagine, if that happens, the ARRL will put those in their go kits, too. I would hope so. I see one. Yeah.
Did I misunderstand you? This is at 25 East, roughly, the position of the satellite?
I've never seen a map that shows the position of satellite, but the maps I've seen for the preliminary positioning cover the west coast of Africa out to somewhere in the middle of the Pacific for phase 4B.
So why?
Oh, he's talking about 4A? I can go back on the...
Talking about a different satellite then? Which one was it that FEMA is involved with?
Which one is which?
Which one is FEMA involved with?
FEMA is more interested in phase 4B, which is the one that's SDR on the satellite and positioned over the United States.
Never mind.
Okay.
Positioned over the Americas, actually.
Yes, that's true.
It goes to South America and North America.
How very United States-centric of me, and I well called.
I think Bob McGuire's talk had an animation last year or something.
We don't own the equator yet.
We also don't own the vehicle. We don't control the vehicle it's on. We're being given a ride thanks to our benefactors, and we will go wherever they take us.
So it's not really an issue of FEMA's going over on our satellite.
Yes.
I was still trying to parse a little bit this presentation. So the idea is from the ground station up, you're transmitting in some small subsegment of all the time that's available. And then on the receive end, you listen to the whole system coming down, and then you pick out the segment you're interested in.
Yeah, so the uplink is an individual different, every ground station that's transmitting on a different frequency, the uplinks are all individual narrow channel ones which are received by this really wide receiver, and then in software, they're all decoded, and it's not exactly TDMA, but they're all inserted, channelized into the DVB encapsulated data stream. And so you only have to receive a single data stream to receive all the channels, but all of the individual streams going up are separate. Okay.
So I have a question about the antenna options here. Geosynchronous versus geostationary. Does that need to be a tracking antenna, or do you just need to occasionally repoint it?
You need to occasionally repoint it.
Okay.
I noticed the uplink was 2.4 gigahertz, and is that uplink in the ham bands, and how close is it to the ISM, which has channels like Wi-Fi that have a lot of static traffic for what we're talking about?
I don't know, but the SHAL satellite, Phase 4A, is using a 2.4 gigahertz up. Phase 4B uses 5 up and 10 down. So it's not a consideration for Phase 4B. The actual frequencies are, I believe, in the paper.
I just wanted to comment about the tremendous benefit that a digital transponder has over an analog one. Do you want to address
that? No, I think, you go.
Yeah, so if you look at an analog transponder, it's going to have a single receiver in it. And if there are multiple transmitters, any one of those could transmit a lot of power and take almost all of the downlink power away, because there's an AGC circuit in there, and whoever has the most power can do that. And commercial satellite operators work very hard to make sure all the people that are on the uplink are balanced. This is totally not true on a digital one. So you can have very weak people and very strong people all received in one digitizing receiver that has a lot of bandwidth on the satellite, a lot of dynamic range, and then it turns around and puts all those in the downlink. So it's much, much more forgiving of having a whole bunch of operators with different powers, different size antennas, all that. So it's a huge advantage to have a digital transponder.
It also means on the downlink that you have one single signal, and you can optimize the power amplifier for that and run that completely optimized and not worry about how you balance all that stuff, basically. Yeah, over here.
Yes, it's my understanding that the uplinks are spread across frequencies. How are those going to be coordinated? Is there going to have to be a separate link somewhere that says you currently are allowed to use this frequency on the uplink?
There will be several. The current design, all of this is flexible, and it's only in software. So how hard can it be to change? Is that there's a number of channels reserved for link establishment, and so you make your initial contact up on one of those channels. It's like Bluetooth, if you know how Bluetooth works. You make your initial contact on one frequency, and then the link control says you've been assigned to this, and then, except we're not going to hop. You just go to that frequency, and then you're done. And so the establishment channels are kind of quickly vacated by the people who are establishing links.
And we can have spatial diversity on the uplink, too.
Uh-oh. We could if we put the right antenna up, I guess. Yeah.
Because you can uplink multiple beams geographically, and then the downlink all comes down on one big beam, and everyone, sorry, Gary, and everyone is on it, on the downlink. So, not necessarily the first satellite.
Right.
But as many channels as you want it to have come up in as many different ways are all digitally merged into one stream.
Yes.
And then everyone receives that one stream. That is the basic concept behind a digital satellite.
Absolutely. Initially, we will only have one antenna that has a wide field of view, but in the future, we'll do this. We'll,
very reminiscent of the microsats launched in 1990.
Any more?
Any other questions? Very lively conversation. All right, hearing no more conversations. Right. Thank you, Steve. Thank you for presenting for Wally. Really appreciate that. And of course, Wallace's... let's do a pat down. Wally's paper is published in the proceedings, so get a chance to read it there. So next up, Nathaniel,
Nathan? Nathaniel?
Is Bill Engelke here? No, Bill? Okay.
Do a quick refresher.
So you'll just fill in for Bill.
Before we get started, I expect a lot of Q&A in this talk. I think everybody's going to be really excited about it. Y'all have mostly lost the concept of standing up. And when you're talking sitting down, I can hear you, but I can't find you. I don't even know where you are. So I get a wide shot of the audience. So please, stand up during Q&A.